Robert Charles, former Assistant Secretary of State under Colin Powell, great to see you today in the University Club on the Capitol TV show. You're most welcome.
It's a privilege to be here with you.
Do you think that the Biden administration is withdrawing from the Middle East? And if it's happening, who is filling the gaps?
Well, I certainly hope not, because I think that we have very strong relationships in the Middle East, and I think they're very important to the future of both the United States and all the countries of the Middle East. I think there is a weakness in leadership right now, and I would like to hope that smart people will realize how vital it is that we stay engaged in the Middle East. However, if we do not stay engaged, you can be assured that China and Russia will find ways to pursue their own advantage in the Middle East. And I worry about that because the United States has always been a broker of peace, trying to bring things together, not push them apart. And I am a little worried that if China and Russia play a bigger role, then we could have some serious problems.
Mm-hmm. You are a top expert on national security. UAE now suspends talks on $23 billion weapons deal with the US. What is your comment on that? What was the reason?
Yes, so just to be clear, I'm not in the government now. Yeah. I'm outside the government, and I read that story. Mm-hmm. And it worried me a little bit because I hope it's just a bump in the road. I hope it's just a small issue. But I have to tell you, I think that that relationship is very important for UAE, even as it is very important for other U.S. allies and for the United States.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that will impact the relation between the UAE and Israel on the other side?
You know, I really don't know about that. I would like to believe that those that are anti-terrorist, those who believe that peace is possible in the Middle East, those who have worked closely with the United States and with each other, can realize, sort of pull themselves to a higher level and realize this is very important. This is not something, you know, sometimes we say for want of a nail, you lose the shoe. For want of a shoe, you lose the army. For want of an army, you lose the war. We can't lose the broader peace just because we have a bump in the road.
Mm-hmm. You were in the Bush administration and you were a senior member of it. Some blames this administration for not stopping Iranians or the Iranian regime to build his nuclear weapons or nuclear facilities. How do you agree on that? Or there was something you can do and you didn't at that time?
I think that one of the great, so I was part of the Bush 41 White House, which was after Reagan, and then for a long time was not in government, and then I was an Assistant Secretary of State with Colin Powell doing operational things during the Bush 43 administration. I think Iran is a source of ill will in the world. I mean, I think they promote terrorism, and I think we all know that. And we need to be cognizant of the fact that if they were to gain a nuclear weapon, it would traumatize the whole world, as well as obviously the Middle East. So my gut is that we should always have been doing more. We should be doing more right now to understand. You know, there's a problem with the way foreign policy works. People like to be wishful thinkers. They would like to believe that the world is not as nasty and difficult a place as it is. The problem is, if you take that view, you end up surprised. When Jimmy Carter was surprised that the Soviets rolled into Afghanistan. Gosh, how'd that happen? Well, if you're thinking forward, you understand that Iran's objectives are not beneficial to world peace. So my own answer to that question is, we need to be leaning forward, doing more. I think Trump was trying to make clear to them that there's no free pass. You're not going to get a nuclear weapon. And Trump was pretty hard-minded about that. Reagan was hard-minded earlier on. Bush 41 was. But at the end of the day, I think you have to take the world as it is. And you have to take the world as it is right now. And Right now, we have to stop that from happening.
So is the negotiation in Vienna worth it? It's going to a happy ending, as we say?
I don't believe so. Mm-hmm. My view, I don't believe in that that deal. I believe that deal was a bad deal. I think it gives Iran, in a sense, a permission to go forward at some point with nuclear weapons, which damage global peace. We're not talking about a country that it is easy to trust. You know, Reagan used to say, trust but verify. And maybe the point is you don't trust if there's a reason not to trust. So I am not a fan of that deal. I think it was a ill-conceived deal. I think it doesn't understand the magnitude of the threat. I don't think it understands the imminency of the threat. And so as a result, I think we need to be much more circumspect, build a coalition of free nations who say, we don't want a nuclear Middle East. That is not good for anybody. It doesn't matter what side you're on. That's not good for anybody.
We're talking now about a military confrontation. You had a great career with the United States Navy. Do you think the U.S. Navy will attack or confront the Iranian Navy in the waters of the Gulf?
You know, the United States Navy is very cognizant, they're very aware, but they're not provocative, but they are also very responsive. So, you know, if you go back to the 1980s, you will remember that the Iranians tried to, they were very aggressive, terrorist activities, as well as attacking, for example, tankers in the Gulf. And you can go back and look at what Reagan did. He was very direct. He destroyed a lot of their oil platforms, he destroyed a lot of their navy. I don't wish that on anyone. I think peace is always better than conflict. But I will say that I think the United States is very, very well aware of where it needs to defend. And if it is attacked, it will defend.
Mm. Do you think the Biden administration will take any decision, or Israel will be the first who confront this Iranian nuclear bomb?
You know, I really don't know. I think that you know, very often what you see and read in the press isn't all of what's happening. And I'd like to believe that behind the scenes, the United States is talking to Europe, talking to our Arab allies, talking to Israel, and saying, look, we need to prevent something happening that essentially allows one country, a country that is known for terrorist activities, to threaten the rest of the world. We cannot allow that to happen. And I don't know of any country in the world that really would want that to happen other than Iran. So I'd like to believe that it would be a unified response, whatever response occurs.
In 2004, you wrote a book called Narcotics and Terrorism. Did you talk about, or did you know at that time about the influence of the terrorist groups funded by Iran?
Yes. They're included in that book. The issue or the primary tenet of that book, which was, it was a short book, but it included a lot of evidence, was the idea, all public evidence, but was the idea that groups like Hezbollah and other groups around the world, quite frankly, profit from narcotics, both in that hemisphere and in this hemisphere. And so the point I was trying to make is that when you're looking at the financing of activities that disrupt human stability, narcotics trafficking is a really big activity, and the terrorist organizations use it. And by the way, that was true of the PKK, the KLA, Hezbollah, FARC, ELN, Shining Path. They all use narcotics as a fuel to run their terrorist machines.
So as an assistant secretary of state for doing trafficking, you worked to stop Afghanistan from cultivating the herbs used now in making drugs. You think that Taliban will go to this business again to fund it themselves?
Yeah, so my job as an assistant secretary of state was both police training around the world, which is a very straightforward sort of process, and counter-narcotics. So Plan Colombia, as you said, trying to turn down the volume of heroin production in Afghanistan. I absolutely do believe that the Taliban will resort to, indeed I think they probably are already, trafficking in drugs just as they traffic in people and just as they traffic in other things, but in particular drugs, because you know, it's a very weak economy. It doesn't have much, it doesn't even have infrastructure, it roads. And so having spent some time over there, you know, it's unfortunately, heroin and the ability to coerce people to produce heroin poppies and then to traffic it is a very profitable thing for the Taliban. That has been profitable for the Taliban in the past.
I think there is something in common between the Houthis, Hezbollah, and Taliban. It's everything forbidden they do, illegal business they do it in included the business of trafficking and drugs. What do you think about? Do you know any? Do you have any information about the Houthis, especially?
I can't say specifically that group, but I will tell you this: there's no respect for rule of law. When there's no respect for rule of law, when there's no respect for individual rights, when there's no respect for the idea that public corruption is bad, when there's a sense that anything goes and that power will justify anything, then people get into drug trafficking, they get into human trafficking, they get into coercing other people. And you know, one of the things that people need to remember is that the greatest level of stability comes from rule of law. So one of the reasons that the United States was deeply involved in Afghanistan, indeed probably the primary reason, in addition to suppressing terrorism, was to try to plant seeds for respect for rule of law.
The GCC summit now it concludes in Saudi Arabia. How do you think the goals now or the challenges that they are facing in the Gulf? What, as an American and a politician, what do you expect from them to do against Iran, against the threats coming from Mullah regime?
You know, I can't predict the future, but I would say that it is very important for, again, I'll sort of say it this way, for free nations, for nations that respect rule of law, who do not want military confrontation to become the norm, it is very important that they stay together in their thinking. And, you know, people are very critical of Donald Trump, and they say, well, he was very brusque. He was very blunt in the way that he managed things. But one of the things he saw was what I'll call reality as it is. And one of the things, you know, that he did in the Middle East was he tried very hard to create bilateral relationships that would strengthen our commitment to a peaceful future. And in a way, what he was doing, which may be what the future really should be made of, is trying to create a patchwork quilt, a fabric in which one country is tied strongly to another and another to another, and then eventually, instead of trying to make everyone agree on everything all the time, get these strong bilateral relationships, and then you have a fabric, a real fabric for preserving peace. And by the way, for isolating countries like Iran that seem intent on disrupting stability and police and peace.
So you believe that the Abraham Accords was a wise step toward stability and security? And
I do. You know, peace is a establishing peace in areas that are rife with conflict, which is one of the things I did, not there, but broadly, is always two steps forward and one step back, and then two steps forward and one step back, until people realize sort of a tipping point where people realize it's worth the extra effort to get there. You know, we all have. I've spent a lot of time in the Middle East, UAE, all over the region, and Saudi, and everywhere. It sort of breaks your heart that there isn't some way for a sort of a fresh generation to say, we can get this right. We can get this right. The long history makes it difficult, and I think what Trump was trying to do was say, let's not try to eat the whole pie at once. Let's take one bite at a time, and maybe by doing that, we can get to a point where we all see the world a little more in terms of our mutual interest.
What about during the Bush administration, you dealt with Saudi Arabia. How much Saudi Arabia is important as an ally to the U.S.? And is there any strategy from Biden now to deal with this country, important country?
So the answer to your question is it's a very important ally. You'll remember that back, as we were talking about before, back in the Reagan days, the AWAC deal was very important to both countries. George Shultz was our Secretary of State then. I knew him a little bit. But that was it's very important that we keep our allies close and that we work with them. So to your first question, I don't think there's any there should be no question mark about how significant our allies in the Middle East are. We have various levels of strength in those relationships, but I think they're all very important. The second question, is there a strategy? You know, I'm not part of this administration. I scratch my head sometimes and ask myself the same question. Is there a strategy? You know, I went to law school with Tony Blinken. I know Tony. I would like to believe, I mean, he's a smart guy. I would like to believe he will figure it out. I sometimes wonder if the job isn't a bit overwhelming for him, because these relationships, it's like a chess game. And a lot of the, it's not like you're starting a fresh chess game. It's like you're coming to the board and there are already pieces all set up in different places. And you have to accept the chessboard that you inherited. And you have to work with that chessboard and try to make advances. And in the best
of, win at the end.
And in to win in the end, which is not necessarily to win. You need to win always, but you know, you can create what's called a win-win, which is what, in an environment where, you know, you have bad guys that get isolated, but the vast majority get together and keep the peace.
What is your approach on the Biden summit for democracy? Some say that it's divided the world, and some others say that it succeeds and it's achieved their goals, because there is a funding for democratic countries to encourage freedom of speech and whatever.
So I'm always in favor of the idea that we encourage self-determination by countries all over the world, which really isn't about countries, it's about people. The sovereignty of a country belongs to the people, it doesn't belong to the government. And so I'm always of the view that if you encourage democracy and freedom, you're doing the right thing. I'm not sure that throwing money at that is as much the answer as strong leadership. And I'll say this about that little summit. You know, in a sense, it sort of seems like a little umbrella in a rainstorm, right? If the broader issue, the broader rainstorm, the broader perception is that you are a weak leader, then that diminishes the commitments that you make. Whereas if you're a strong leader and you make just a small commitment, people will believe you and they will absolutely work with you. Having worked with great leaders, and I will count Ronald Reagan, George Herbert Walker Bush, and Colin Powell, all great leaders, their word was their bond. If they said they would do something, they would do it. And so if I tell you, you want a commitment from me at a level of 10, and I tell you, I can't give you a level of 10, but I can give you a level of 3 and you can count on it, okay? Then if you're talking about a strong leader, the strong leader, we believe our strong leaders because their word is good. But if I'm a weak leader and I say, 10, I'll give you 11.
So this is what's happening now?
I fear that the perception, again, I'm not in this government, but my perception is that someone who will run away from Afghanistan, someone who will not understand the gravity and the interconnectedness of some of these global issues, they may not intend to be a weak leader, but they are perceived as a weak leader. And so you have to reverse that.
But withdrawing from Afghanistan was the Trump administration proposition or...
But you see, the way the Trump administration foresaw a removal of us from Afghanistan was, first, you don't abandon the progress made. So by way of example, women all over Afghanistan, after 20 years, were just about to get into leadership positions. They had been given educational opportunities that they'd never had before, government opportunities never before, private sector opportunities. Our infrastructure processes were on the way to success, okay? And, you know, if you look back over time and you say, well, we needed to get out, the answer is yes, of course. We are not an empire. We need to get out. But you can't let go the kite string and assume the kite is going to keep flying if you haven't really secured it. Or to put it differently, you know, you can't throw a rescue line to somebody and say, hold on tight, and then drop your end of the line and go rescue somebody else. That doesn't
work. The important failure, or the most failure thing, is leaving the Americans behind.
Well, that is a very, very heartbreaking issue, and it's not one getting a lot of press. As of today, I am told that there are 100,000 U.S. credentialed individuals still in Afghanistan. And so what does that really mean? It means they're SIV visa holders, they're former embassy personnel, they're people who worked with the United States military, they're permanent green card holders, and even some American citizens tied to families. You know, we were there for 20 years, so families develop and grow up. And you know, my feeling is that if our word is not our bond, if we do not believe what we say and have others believe what we say because it's true, then they won't believe us the next time. So then we say to China, hey, don't invade Taiwan or we'll respond. And they say, yeah, like in Afghanistan.
Hey, Maria Maalouf here. Please click to like and subscribe to Maria Maalouf TV YouTube page and catch our hottest interviews and most compelling analysis. You will not get it anywhere else.